Hey everyone, it's David with Neo7CNC, and I have another laser review for you today. Let's talk about the Atomstack P9. All right, so usually with these videos, I'm gonna show you how it was packed, how I received it, and what the assembly process was like, and we'll do that over on this side as usual. So when I received it, it was in a plain brown box. I opened that box to find a more retail box. That's the box that I showed you in the very beginning of the video. And it looked like it had taken a little bit of a hit on the corner, but this thing was so well packed with foam, as thankfully all of these units that I've ever tested are. They're cocooned quite nicely, and it had no impact, literally and figuratively, on the machine. It was perfectly fine. All right, so one nice advantage of a machine this small is we can just put it on the table and talk about it without having to have a super wide angle lens. And so let's just start from the front. So like I mentioned before, this machine, the brain box, let's say, is the same as the X7 Pro. Has the same touchscreen connected with this HDMI cable to the controller box. And then on the controller box, you've got your e-stop, you've got your power in, you've got your USB in, your power switch, your reset button, and then a small SD card slot. So you can run jobs from this unit, so you don't have to have it connected to a computer. And as a reminder, the little screen here is magnetic and it just sticks to the front like that. We'll go look at the back. Not much to see here. On this end, there is nothing other than the stand itself. And speaking of stand, these are metal. This looks to be, what, 3 millimeter, 2.5 millimeter metal legs. So they're not plexiglass or some type of plastic or acrylic like some of the other machines are. So that's going to give you a little bit of a firmer foundation for this machine to work on. Going back to the front, let's talk about the laser head. So like I said, this is the exact same head that's on the X7 Pro, same adjustments and everything, which is really a nice feature. This rides in a T-slot on the back, and then you've got your knob here that tightens it up when you get it into the focused position. As a reminder, focusing this unit, there's a 2 millimeter focusing card that you put on top of whatever it is you're trying to engrave or cut. You drop the laser down onto that focusing card, you tighten it up, you remove the focusing card, and your focus is set. This is a fixed focus laser, so once you give it that 2 millimeter offset, you're ready to do your jobs. The motion on this unit is very similar to pretty much everything else I've reviewed and any 3D printers that you may or may not have seen. It has some plastic bearing supported wheels with eccentric nuts for adjustment, and that allows you to dial in the tightness that the wheels grip this rail. You want it to be firm so it's not wobbling around, but you don't want it to be so tight that it causes the motors to work harder than they need to. So it's a little bit of a dance. I did not have to do any adjustment to this machine out of the box. They haven't all been like that. The A5 was like that. The X7 required a little bit of a tweak on the X-axis. This one was good to go right out of the box. But the adjustment is no big deal at all, and they give you the tools that you need to do that. Once again, this is a 10 watt laser that actually has two 5.5 watt laser heads in it that are actually combined in a prism, and that gives you an aggregate of 10 watts of optical power, which allows you to cut much faster. You can do engravings with deeper color at faster speeds. I highly recommend, if you're looking at getting a machine like this, whether it's the Atomstack or not, I would highly suggest going the 10 watt route. If it's gonna be something that you think you're really gonna put some hours on, because you'll save some time with that extra capability. Let's flip it over and look at the bottom. So assembly of this unit was very easy. You really just have this rail, the motor's already attached to it. You do have to add the end caps. And then probably the trickiest thing, which really wasn't tricky, was putting this belt in. And I did notice with the instructions that they showed this belt as being a continuous loop belt. For the model that I received, and I don't know whether the model is lagging or the instructions are lagging, I was using the paper instruction booklet that came with it. This is actually a length of belt that has, and I don't know if you can see that in the shot, but it has these two little brass crimps that are on the end of the belt to kind of give it some purchase when you slide it in these slots. You basically slide one end down, install this bearing assembly, which is just two bearings, a spacer, and a screw. wrap it around, go around the motor pulley, and then back, and then slide it in. And you'll just have to make sure that doesn't come off while you tighten the stepper motor. And that's very easily done. There's a screw on the bottom here, and there's a screw on the top on this side. You loosen those up, you pull the motor back, and then you tighten them up, and that puts the tension on the belt. And this is very snug. It worked fine for all the testing that I did. The wiring setup couldn't be much easier. You have a wire that goes from this connector to the head, and you can't mess this up because the connectors are specific, and the only ones that are similar are this one and this one. But the instructions in the book tell you that when you take this wire that only has two connectors on it, this one can only go in one slot, and then that one is the motor, and then this is for the laser power. So pretty straightforward there. You can see the bearings on the bottom. While we're down here, this unit has home sensors, or home switches, let's say. And so as this unit goes all the way in, this little arm right here is touching a very small micro switch that's right there. You probably can't hear that, but I can. And so then there's another one here for the Y-axis, and that runs into this little screw post here. And that's kind of important. I didn't really think it was important early on, but as I've started to review more and more of these devices, the home switches, I don't know what that costs to put that in a machine, but it's very much a feature that if I were going out and buying one, I would want one that had home switches. Because when you start this machine up, whether it's set to auto home, which you can control that in the software, or not, if you go into Lightburn, which is the program that I use to basically do all my jobs with these machines, I can hit the home switch and this machine will home the X and then home the Y. And it says, okay, this is my starting position. Why is that important? Well, if you have a fixture set up, sorry about that. If you have a fixture set up where you do jobs a lot, like let's say I'm doing these little dog tags, and I've printed up some fixtures that just happen to hold these very nicely, and I've got this set up, I've got this machine anchored down, and this is a repeatable job that I need to do quickly and accurately, then this home position is important because the machine says, okay, when I'm here, this is my 0, 0, this is where I start from, and that sets the point where it goes out here. So once you've got this position of this dialed into your jobs and your software, then the machine will go over and it will start doing the right job in the right spot. So it can be important. If you're just tinkering and trying to learn the whole laser, I guess, family, or it's just a new tool for you and you're playing around, it may not be that important. If you're looking at it from more of an efficiency standpoint, I think the home switches are good to have. All right, so let's talk about what came with the unit. I've already mentioned the kind of metal tray for keeping the laser power from getting to your workbench or your work surface. I've already mentioned the focusing card. It comes with a standard kind of plug-in power supply as well as a USB cable, but there's a few other things. The most notable are these feet-looking things right here. It comes with four of these, and these are actually used when you're setting the machine up or when you're putting it together. They kind of act as axle stands for the unit while you're putting it together, and it kind of helps you line it up. There is some amount of play with the beam that is the Y-axis, and you've got the cantilevered feet. Those holes are not, that's not a close fit, and that's probably by design to give you some flexibility, because you are dealing with a machine that has a mass that's overhanging, and you're going to need to dial in the angle of those feet to compensate, because if you were to have it all the way in and you set your focus, gravity is going to pull that down as it goes out. And I'm kind of alluding to something that we'll talk about in the pros and cons, but these stands help you kind of set up the machine in a better, more accurate way. So that's helpful. These also act as risers if you're trying to do something that's thicker that wouldn't normally fit under the machine, or you could possibly be using the AtomStack rotary add-on that you can put under the machine, and these would help lift it up so you can do that more easily. So that's a nice touch. It comes with the necessary tools, and in this case it's just a couple of Allen wrenches and then a standard open-end wrench for adjusting that eccentric nut if you need to tighten up the wheels on either of the axes. It comes with three little plywood test blanks, three black acrylic test blanks, and they're black for a reason. LED based lasers do not like clear material in general. It's got your standard fare of zip ties for securing the wires. Interesting enough, I didn't need to use those. It's got a little cleaning pin. It has, they call this non-woven fabric. It's a very fine fabric, and I use that to kind of clean the inside of the filter lens that's on the front. And then you have a what looks like a micro USB or a standard thumb drive is actually a micro SD reader, and it comes with a card. And I believe that was 4 gigs. But that's a nice touch to have that included with the unit. All right, let's get to it. What did I make with the P9? Man, I spent a lot of time looking for cool things, interesting things to cut out, and I hope I've got some good ones for you today. So let's just get right into it. So one of the first things I did was, okay, I got a 10 watt laser. Let's see what I can do with it. So again, half inch piece of pine. This is 12.56 millimeters, and this is solid pine. And I was easily able to go through this like the other 10 watt lasers that I have tested in the past. It does quite a good job. Again, I'll have all the speeds and feeds on the screen as I always do. I did bump it up one notch this time and do a 19.4 millimeter or just shy of 3/4 inch, 0.749 inches, close enough. And I was not able to get through this. And it was interesting, and I could talk about this for a few minutes, but I'll try to do it quickly. So the first cut I did, and I set it up to where the laser would go outside the material because I wanted to just be able to look at it and see how far it went down instead of having to cut it like I did the last time. So with 15 passes, 100% power, and 500 millimeter speed, I got 15.5 millimeters. And I'm like, okay, well, if I'm that close, I'm sure we can get through this. I did 20 passes. And it went 12.3 millimeters, so less. Interesting. The wood grain is completely different on this side. It's more curved up, going vertical, whereas this is more flat, almost flat, kind of laid down. Less layers in the tree on this side than this side. So I'm like, okay, that's interesting. So I did the same cut again, and it's really, really close to the edge. So as the laser was doing its work, you could see the light shining through the end of the board here. And what I discovered, and this was counterintuitive to me until I saw it with my own eyes, was as the laser is going around, it's low. You see the spot come through low, and then it would go high, and then it would go low again. And what that's doing is the laser beam is running into one of these bands in the structure of the tree, in the fibers of the tree. And so it was putting up a fight. So I tried it two more times. I did the first one I did was 20, 25, 30. On 30, it was really, really close. But I kind of gave up because I'm like, how many passes? I kind of ran out of patience. And at what point is this feasible for this kind of material? You'll have to decide. For me, that was where I called it. If you're doing stuff like this, that is well within the range and work duty for a CO2 laser, not an LED-based desktop laser. Some simple stuff I did was this really nice little tiger head. And I wanted to kind of see how fine I could get it. So I did it on this piece of craft paper tag. And thanks to the good old folks at Banggood, we have a new digital microscope, and we're gonna look at this later on so you can see just how detailed it is. And I'll have some good shots of that. But it looks great. Again, you know, if I was running a little craft store or something like that, or like a clothing, boutique clothing outlet, or you know, custom gifts, making your own tags is just kind of like that extra touch. And this machine would be great for that, as a lot of these lasers are. I did kind of another sugar skull, and I think I cooked it a little bit too long on this one because it's kind of dark, but I was really just playing around and doing some kind of designations for, you know, doing a laying the tag up there so I could do it. I've already talked about in a different part of the video, I've already talked about this test job that I have available on the website for free. Feel free to download that. I tried doing a QR code, and I don't know if this is going to show up, if you can see through there. I cooked it a little long and it blew right through the paper. I was doing 300 millimeters a minute, but it was the laser power was too much and it blasted holes in it. So I had to tone it back a little bit and was able to get a good mark, a good readable mark, both in the teeny tiny, which looks to be a roughly a half inch square, to basically an inch and a quarter square, or let's call that 12 millimeters and 30 millimeters-ish. Got a good mark. This is just some, it's not really, it's a little bit lighter than cardstock, but some heavy craft paper. I did the old favorite, and that's the This Is a Test tag, the same craft tag that I did the Tiger with, and it did very good on this. Even with it being a cantilevered machine, the lines are nice and straight. They're not scalloped, and the laser really put a hurting on this and blew right through it. You sometimes have the little hanging pieces, but a little flick like that usually knocks them loose. And you can dial in the speeds and feeds or the power. Well, the power was 100%, but you can dial in the speed to where the removal of the waste is a little bit easier. And sometimes it falls out. I already showed you the tag just in passing, but the standard stainless steel tag test. And another thing that we'll look at with the new microscope from Banggood is going to be this verification of what I've mentioned to you before. These desktop LED-based lasers cannot really impact the surface of this to erode it like a laser in wood where it eats it away. It can't do that to stainless steel, but David, there's a mark on there. Again, this is annealing the metal. It's putting a color change into the metal. It's putting heat into the metal. And an awesome discovery using the microscope from Banggood is that I can show you that now. You can actually see where the heat is soaked into the material and it colors out. You can't see it with the naked eye so much, but under magnification, it's very obvious what the laser is doing. And I think you'll find that interesting. So we'll look at that here in a minute. Funny story, I found a puzzle creation website and I made a puzzle. And here's all the pieces. I don't have it put together. I'll have a picture of all the pieces. It's really hard to put the puzzle together when you don't know which side is up. And I didn't paint one side of the board. And sometimes when you're doing laser work, you get smoke on the top and the bottom of the part. So it was really confusing. It will cut puzzles. And there are websites, I'll put a link down below so that they get credit for it, but a free puzzle creation that'll create the file that you need to cut it on your laser. So that was fun. I could see people having a lot of fun with that because you could take an image that you like, do that job first, and then turn it into a puzzle, and that would be super cool. I probably should have done that, and that way I would have been able to put it back together. So yeah. So something else is this was a ton of work. I don't remember, it'll be on the screen. I don't remember how long this took, but it was not a short job to do. But I made this wood fabric. So it freed it up. They're all kind of little corkscrews of the material, and it just turned this plywood into something rather flexible. So that was a lot of fun. Some people can make hinges out of this material, and it just turned out really, really good. And again, back to my earlier comment about a 10-watt laser, you're gonna appreciate having a 10-watt laser if you're trying to do stuff like this, because this takes time. So that was cool. I brought back an old one. So I did this design on this piece of slate. This was a requested material from some time ago, and it turned out awesome when I did it, and it was super fast to do. Let me back up. So the first time I did this, I did like a B, and there was discoloration on it. And again, you're dealing with a natural material, so you don't know if that's the material talking or if it had grease or something from the manufacturing process on it, or oil, or somebody had handled it. I had handled it and put fingerprint oil on it or something like that. I don't know. What I ended up doing was hitting this one with it's a really strong cleaner for like when you're going to powder coat something. And I used it on here, let it evaporate off, and I didn't touch the surface, and I put it under the laser, and the mark came out just gorgeous. And it popped even more to kind of add some longevity to this, and that's why it's got kind of a sheen or a shine to it. I don't know if you can see that, but I hit it with two coats of spray lacquer, and it made the slate get super dark, which made the laser mark just pop, and it really looks good. I have some microscope shots of this too, so we'll look at that here in a second. All right, so one thing that I always try to do, I'm not always successful, but I always try to bring a new material to bear and let's see what the laser will do to it. I almost need to start a series called Mythbusters Desktop Laser Edition, which I may do, and you know, let me know down below if that's something you would like to see. There are things that I have tried that I haven't showed you, and it's not because I don't want to show you, it's just because I didn't know if you would want to see them. But this was a special request, and I was like, I'm curious, I'll bite. And so this nondescript piece of thermoplastic is Kydex. This is typically used to make sheaths for knives, to make gun holsters, all sorts of things. You can heat this up and it'll basically form to whatever mold you put it on. You can pull a vacuum on it and suck it down. And once it cools, you have a very tough container for whatever it is you're trying to do. And so I've never really played with this stuff before. So I shot four holes in it, you can see right there. And some of them are a little bit charred, one of them not so much. And I started like 10 passes and I was basically lighting this stuff on fire. I ultimately found out after trying it four times and getting soot all over my hands that I could do it in two passes and have way less charring, if any. Actually not much at all, which was good, because you don't want that. But it is doable. And now this is black, so that might play differently. That goes back to the black plexiglass tags that they give you. The lasers respond better to a darker color. So maybe I'll do a piece of white Kydex or a lighter color Kydex and see if we have the same results and see what the cut actually looks like, because it might be that it burns it. We just can't see it because it's the black material. So that was an interesting experiment. Now, another thing that I got from Banggood that has facilitated a lot of these tests and made them a little bit easier to do is this expanded mesh aluminum, basically laser bed. And so you can't see or smell what I smell, but all the sap or soot that comes out of the wood, you know, it can kind of get into this, but this allows the cut to kind of breathe. And what that is, and they include this backer piece too, you can see the discoloration on that, and that's after I cleaned it. When you're doing all these laser jobs, this gives it the ability for the laser to punch all the way through. If you were just using like a metal sheet only at the bottom, you may not get the same effect, because that metal sheet's going to be acting as a heat sink, and you need the laser heat to do the work. So this allows the laser to more easily go through the materials that you're working on without any hindrance. These come in all different shapes and sizes, but I'll have links to this as well as the microscope that we're going to look at down below. And yeah, it's a huge help. It does take up some room because this is roughly an inch tall, but if you've got the real estate to give up under the laser head, this makes a lot of these jobs so much easier, especially if you're doing something like this and the pieces fall out, then they actually have the ability just to go down in here so that they're not sticking up and getting in the way of the laser head and moving this piece around. So this is very helpful. All right, so let's talk some pros and cons. So on the pro side, it's 10 watts. Again, if you're looking at the P9 or the X7 or the X-Tool D1 or whatever machine comes out tomorrow, I would highly recommend that you go the 10 watt route. It's going to give you more capability with the machine. It's going to allow you to do engravings and certain things faster than a 5 watt. And it might just be an overall more enjoyable experience because you're not waiting so much. So that's the first thing, the 10 watt. The price of this unit at the time of filming was $599. And to compare it to other 10 watt machines that I have tested, which would be, I think the only one that I've tested is the X-Tool D1 is the other 10 watt, and the X7 Pro. You know, the X-Tool D1, as I received it, was somewhere in the $800 range. Now it came with some other items, and I believe it was on sale at the time. So just know that that's a difference. You know, the big difference between these two are going to be the construction. You have the same capability on the head, but it's going to be the construction. You know, the P9 has a screen, the X-Tool D1 doesn't, you know, different things like that. You just have to decide what features are more important to you. Back to the pros. So on the P9, the metal construction, you know, this is indicative of all the AtomStack machines that I've reviewed. They do a great job at construction. Those aren't plastic cantilever legs like some machines have, and it's more capable to handle the weight and what it's doing. And the fact that it's a heavier machine because of how it's constructed actually helps it stay planted as it's doing its cut. So that's going to potentially lead to better cut quality to a point. If you start whipping this thing around and driving it like you stole it, then you're going to see a lot of deviations in your cut quality or your image quality. So just know that. The simple focus, I can't stress this enough. The fact that all I got to do is put down what I'm trying to engrave or cut and throw this little business card size piece on it, use the big fat knob on the front of the laser, drop it down until I hit the focus card, tighten the knob back up, remove the focus card, and I'm done. It's one of the simpler focusing methods that I've seen, and I appreciate that. This machine does offer offline use. That's not everybody's cup of tea, meaning that you can use the machine without it connected to a computer. So you could create a job and just have it stored on the SD card, and you can just repeat that job over and over again. If you're doing this for production or for, like, you know, jobs that you repeat a lot, that could be beneficial. The touchscreen also, when you're doing those jobs, makes setting up and queuing those jobs very easy. And it's easy to look at. It's a good touchscreen. The fine detail, I did double check, and it is 0.08 millimeters by 0.08 millimeters on the dot resolution. And so that's some of the finest that's out there now. On the laser, back to the laser focusing, the slot that the laser head rides up in up and down in, when you lock it to lock the height, that is a captive track. So it keeps that head parallel, or perpendicular rather, to the work area, and that's important. I've reviewed other machines in the past that they have a screw on one side and a screw on the other, and so there's really no good way to know that you don't have the head cocked to one side or the other unless you get down there and look at it or put a level on it or something like that, which you don't want to have to do. So this machine, like the X-Tool D1, it constrains the head so it can only go up and down, and that's a plus. An interesting one that I added to the pros was the fact that they have those little riser feet in there, the little stands. Now that's used for construction, but some forward-thinking person said we could use that for also raising it up. So it has an additional feature that allows you to use it to lift the machine up so you can use a rotary under it, or you can engrave something that's taller. And I think that's excellent. I always love when people come up with other ways to use things that you have to have anyway. That just makes a lot of sense. So on the cons, the smaller work area, I've already alluded to that. This is 220 by 250, whereas the X7 Pro or the X-Tool D1 or even the A5 Pro, you know, those are all roughly in the 400 millimeter by 400 millimeter range, the X-Tool being slightly bigger than that. But if that's not an issue for you, and you need the portability that this machine affords, because it is, you just kind of pick it up and just walk off with it. It's you know, you'll have to decide, again, like most of these features, you'll have to decide what's more important to you. But the caveat to this being a cantilevered style machine is you may not be able to drive it as fast as you want to and maintain quality of your image or your cut. I didn't see anything that was like, oh, I can't deal with that. But just know you're not going to be able to drive a cantilevered machine as fast as you would like a box machine, something like an X-Tool or the X7 Pro or more of those box style machines. So just know that. All right, so that's the review of the AtomStack P9. If you have questions, please leave those down below. And also, if you know of additional materials that we can try, leave those down below as well. As always, I'll have links to everything used in this video down below. I'll also have them on the neo7cnc.com post about this particular review. You can find more information, more pictures, a little bit more details there as well. I look forward to seeing you in the next video. I've got some interesting ones coming up, some different things other than laser engravers to talk about. So please be sure to hit that subscribe button, and we'll see you next time.